be a professional artist, I, you know, said, well, you know, the standard thing. What do you want to be when you grow up? Well, I want to be an artist. Oh, okay, an artist. Where's your backup plan, right? Where's your backup plan? So, you know, but because I'm so emotionally connected to it, and I've always been, there has to be an equation. There has to be an equation. There has to be a solution. There has to be not something that's emotionally connected, but there has to be some logic to it. And I think over the years, now that I'm 46 years old, I think the logical answer is to sell out. You have to sell out. You have to sell out. And the reason I also believe that is because the moment you receive funding for art, you've sold out. The moment you paid to associate yourself to art, you've sold out. The moment you sell one painting, you sell out. So why not just multiply that as many times as you possibly can and then be able to continue to do the thing that you're so passionate about for your entire life continuously and consistently. This is how it really, really started. A professor in philosophy class put this line on the chalkboard, and he then began to explain that the line is what we use to create everything. Mankind uses this for science, mankind uses this for chemistry, we use this for architectural purposes, we use it for engineering, we use it for computers, we use it for storytelling, filmmaking. It is what man uses to make any object. Well, then I started thinking, well, if that's the case, then in a line, there are points from one line to the next. How do you get from one point to the next? Linear thinking. And if I want to be an artist, what do I need to do to go from one point to the next? Now, if I have, how many options do I have when I'm going to point A to B? Just so you know, I'm going to interrupt you. This is all up here. It's not going to make any sense to you at all. None at all. Remember, I'm an artist, but I'm talking about logic. From point A to point B, the professor clearly stated that there are an infinite amount of points between two points, an infinite. And I started to say with myself, well, if there's an infinite amount of points, what if I just found one for myself? So if the possibilities are infinite, there's no big issue here. It's not that difficult. You only have to find one in infinity. Second question, my senior year in sculpture class, something similar to this, I was given 20 minutes, every student was given 20 minutes to give an oral presentation of this from this question, what is good art? Well, you know, I'm a senior and I'm thinking to myself, well, you know, I've spent 4 years, I got a lot of A's, I was very studious, I was doing good artwork, this is an easy question. But what happened was all the presentations prior to mine, I then started to argue. It was a constant argue. The person would say this, case in point, which was my favorite, good art means it is consistently aesthetically relevant. And that one really got me. I said, you know, I think that's what good art really could be. But then I started to say, well, what if it was consistently, inconsistently aesthetically relevant, so that an artist then would do 100 paintings and none of them looked alike, wouldn't that inconsistency necessarily mean that is now good? So consistent or inconsistent, good art could exist. That then led me to believe that art really is an object developed from the use of tools. That's all I do. That's all I do all day. I have a set of tools and I create art. These are our tools. These are our tools. A could be acrylic, B could be bronze, C could be cutting, E could be efficiency, F could be fabric, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And the numbers are our measurements. They're like a recipe. You put certain amounts of this and it's just a soup. It's just a soup of putting things together. Well, what if you made the formula a little more complex? Talent, then, to me, means that this formula that you've constructed in your own head to create artwork means your differentiator is in an infinite amount of possibilities to just find one more point to add to the one that already exists. Now you're original. So, an object plus one. This is the basis of my education, an object plus one. Well, all right, I'm a senior year. I figured it out as an artist. So, I need a job. Because an object plus one on a resume gets you nowhere. It gets you absolutely nowhere. So I don't know how many of you are familiar with the story, but I became a truck driver. A truck driver so I can supplement my income so that I can continuously, A, raise a family, and then also do my art. You need those dollars. I had not yet sold out. But what's most interesting to me about this truck driving experience is, you know, this here's the correlation. What I did for a living was go from point A to point B, over and over and over. Point A to point B. I mean, and this is running through my head again. So what's this all mean? And what's most interesting is when I was going from point A to point B, I was hauling objects. Objects. And I'm saying, so okay, this object was made. I make objects. Why am I hauling other people's objects? Wouldn't it be nice if I hauled my own objects? And I would take these objects, and this story was the one that really clicked for me. I was in a little town in Virginia. And it was, on one end was all this cotton. And cotton was being dumped into the plant. And I was curious, okay, what happened to the other end? What's the process? How did this cotton, what is this cotton doing from point A to B? Well, I went all the way to the other side, and there was spools of threads. Just spool of thread, white thread. And I just started asking questions. This has got me on a mind frame that every time I went to a manufacturing plant, I would start asking a bunch of questions because it was raw materials moving in on one end, and then on the other end came some object of some sort. And the process in between was an artistic experience that's none other. It's amazing. It was absolutely amazing to see a bed spring made. It's amazing to see how a screw is made. It's amazing to see how thread is made, and et cetera, and et cetera. And I did that for 14 years. And you notice the charts? Assembly process, manufacturing process. Well, I happen to look up the creative process. What's different? What's different? Not a lot. A lot of arrows. A lot of arrows. A lot of shapes and a lot of arrows. But the process the same. Boring. Boring. I'm saying I am an artiste. What's a plant? What does cotton have to do with anything, right? Well, then I said, well, what's interesting is that the products, these goods and these objects that I were hauling from point A to point B really were brands. They were organizations, they were corporations that figured out that a bed spring was an object that was necessary for beds. But the corporation who made the bed springs was absolutely ridiculously in your face, buy my bed springs. Buy them. And then you buy them, I'm going to make more, and you get to sleep on a nice, comfortable bed. So I'm like, okay, why can't artists start thinking like that? Why can't what I make make you comfortable? And if I want to make you comfortable, if there's a value to my object, if it means what it means, and if it's important to culture, then maybe I should manufacture enough of it so that everyone has an opportunity to have it. So then, that then breaks it down to this most simple form: process, tools, formula, talent, and branding. Sell out. Then it came to, all right, well then how do you explain this? And imagine this. Here's your homework assignment. Imagine this. This gentleman going to his wife and say, hey honey, I got an idea. I made this leather sphere. And I have this basket. What I want you to do is throw this leather spear into this basket, and I'm going to call it basketball. It's going to be call it basketball. Now, get this. This game of basketball has a process. The tools are the ball and the basket. The formula are the rules and regulations. And in these rules and regulations, there are a lot of variables. A lot of things happen. There's spontaneity, but there's structure. And you know what? What's going to be really good about this game is we're going to get the most talented people to perform this process. And we're going to brand it. And we're going to brand it so well that it will be distributed regionally. It'll be scalable. And matter of fact, it's going to be so scalable that in the educational systems of America, they will make sure kids play basketball at an early age, and people will love the game all the way until their retirement. And we're going to make it accessible to the entire audience. So again, if we talk about these formulaic variables, let's talk about the letter A. The game of sports is about the athlete, right? But the process, if you were to substitute an athlete for an artist, would it work? Would it work? Absolutely. It would absolutely work. The problem is there's an organization that is branding the process. There's an organization that is branding the tools. There's an organization that is branding talent, and there's an organization that is branding the formula. Now, that's a picture of me getting out of my truck and selling it to try to go out and tell everybody what I think. You see how angry I look? I mean, seriously. And I look at this picture all the time because, you know, that was security. That was security. And at that age, to go into an industry in which I didn't feel as secure because there was no avenue, the industry was extremely difficult. I've spent my time and with the partners that I have looking at the art industry. And I also believe that Milwaukee will lead nationally an industry movement in which you'll see artists having studios. I just believe it, that there'll be hundreds of studios, there'll be hundreds of manufacturing plants by local artists making goods and services and selling them to the world, and we're all happy and we get to dance and have booze and all that other stuff us artists want to do. That's it, thank you. Yeah.